Thank you very much. It's a great honour to be here. To start off, I'll just show a picture from the only effort I've made on the overturning circulation, the Atlantic Meridian overturning circulation, which is a picture of a chimney, which leads into what I wanted to say about Walter. And I'll show you the link. This is a feature in the central Greenland Sea. There are two places in the northern North Atlantic where deep convection occurs and helps to drive the Atlantic overturning circulation. One is in the Labrador Sea, where cooling is the cause, but the other's in the Greenland Sea, where the main cause is or has been addition of salt to the ocean from production of ice in a particular very limited region of the Greenland Sea. And so this has produced these features called chimneys, which are extraordinary narrow rotating columns of water extending down with uniform properties, in this case down to 2,500 meters. And here we can see a chimney with a shown by the minus 1 degree temperature contour penetrating through some warmer water at minus 0.9 degrees. So this is quite a powerful type of feature, very long-lived as well. That I was led, the work that I was doing was to lead an EU project called, unexcitingly called, Convection, in which we mapped the chimneys in the central Greenland Sea through 3 winters and 2 summers. And we found particular chimneys at least appeared to have long lifetimes. They would be covered with fresh water in the summer and then reappear at the surface in the winter. So this is the place where they grew, it's a feature which was due to a cold current coming out from East Greenland Current, the Odden ice tongue, and ice was produced, as in the bottom of the slide, very rapidly in the form of pancake ice, and that led to rapid salt rejection and a lot of ice and a lot of addition of density at the surface, which helped to produce the chimneys. Its features are still very much unknown. This was an old slide, but not many of these questions have been answered. And then the right-hand side shows a cross-section of some CTD transects we did that show that how the chimney punches through warmer water on its way down, and its influence, in fact, extends to the seabed. So, but the real reason I wanted to show this was this picture, which struck me recently as something that ocean scientists do, or all scientists, which is the use of false colour imagery, with the emphasis on the false. That is to say, we're used to producing beautifully coloured images which make things look more real or make more believable. And in the case of a chimney, you want a chimney to look like a chimney. So hence the red colour and that kind of sheen on the surface which you get on English Victorian chimney pots. And the ratio of width to height is in the picture is just right for a chimney pot. In reality, it would be about 1,000 times flatter than that. So that's the use of false colour imagery, and also the fact that this was made to resemble a British chimney pot, because I was in Britain and wanted to convince British scientists that this was really a chimney. So this brings me to what I really wanted to say, which was Walter Monk and Britain, and one or two words about that. And Walter has always enjoyed visiting Britain, and he's very much fated when he comes. And he's a fellow of the Royal Society. He's a fellow also of Churchill College, which is a modern Cambridge College, science-based college, which where I was doing my undergraduate work. But his longest visit to Britain was a visit to DAMPT, the Department of Applied Maths and Theoretical Physics in Cambridge, which he carried out with Carl Wunsch. And DAMPT now is a glossy glass palace divided into pavilions, vaguely inspired by IGPP. But then it was a festering, disgusting, converted book warehouse in the middle of Cambridge. I don't have a picture of it, luckily. And Rabbit Warren, and the two greatest visiting scientists that they ever had, which was Walter and Carl, were forced to sit back to back in a room resembling a broom cupboard or janitor's closet. Therefore, they had to interact intimately because otherwise one of them couldn't get to the door. The other thing about Dampt was it had a disgusting smell because they used a kind of green linoleum, which they constantly doused with some characteristic disinfectant. And so anybody living in Dampt or sitting in Dampt would gradually get affected by these noxious fumes. So we had these two distinguished scientists sitting together in a closet affected by fumes. And the result of that was ocean acoustic tomography. Which was a book which opened up an entirely new field in oceanography. So they obviously had the right idea with Old Dampt. But when Walter visited, when he visits any lab, he always goes for the students first and always tries to inspire them with new ideas and questions and help. And this is a characteristic thing that Walter's always done. And I'd just like to say how he first affected me in that way in 1970. And I was just arrived at Scott Polar Institute in Cambridge to do a PhD. And Scott Polar Institute is not really an oceanographic institute. So the director, Gordon Robin, could only offer me one possible oceanographic type project for PhD, which was to study the interaction of ocean waves and sea ice. And nobody knew anything about that then, and he'd just done one cruise with a shipborne wave recorder to the Antarctic and got some fairly equivocal results, which were written up in the Phil Transroy SOC, and it happened to be in the same issue as Walter's classic paper on waves across the Pacific. So all the readers of Phil Transroy SOC would get their volume delivered, and they'd go for Walter's paper, but they find Gordon Robin's paper on waves in ice as a sort of add-on following on from it. So they get to read that as well. So therefore the paper got more publicity than it deserved, I think. Since there was no data at all, it was an ideal PhD topic because nobody was working on the field and there wasn't any data. But I was wondering, how on earth can I get some measurements? How can I do some measurements of waves under ice? And there were these ice floes heaving around in the marginal ice zone, really hard to do anything with. And that was when Walter visited the lab, and he immediately suggested something which he had proposed back in 1960, which was a method of measuring waves, and not necessarily in ice, but anywhere, using a submerged submarine. So you have a submarine hover at a depth great enough that it's not heaving, and then you use a sequence of upward-looking echosounders along the deck, switching from one to others in order to generate a directional wave spectrum. So that would turn out to be a plan that was written up by Makovsky and Mechlin, who were two US Navy scientists, and appeared in a wonderful volume, which was then a kind of Bible, called Ocean Wave Spectra, published in 1963. It's still good stuff in it, but it's more like an Old Testament now. And it was proposed but not carried out, so Walter drew attention to this. And luckily, by an amazing fluke, the director of my lab, Gordon Roman, had been on submarines during the war, and his boss was now chief of the British submarine fleet. And they were about to send a nuclear submarine to the North Pole, the Dreadnought, and proposed to send a diesel submarine as an escort and safety ship, which was a bit bizarre because can't go very far into the ice, so it's not going to that's more likely to be the ship that needs rescuing than the ship that does rescuing. So, but they did it, and here it is, the Oracle, one of the last of the diesel subs. And they said, well, while it's waiting there at the ice edge for the dreadnought to go to the pole, your student can do wave measurements. So I took this, my first ship that was my very own research ship, to the ice edge north of Fram Strait, and did this work hovering under the ice, but only with one echo sounder because they only had one. So we could generate one-dimensional spectra, but not directional spectra. And it was very good, it worked. And we got the first data on wave attenuation in the marginal ice zone, and showed that it was exponential, so there must be a scattering process at work, and found that the attenuation rate was much greater for short waves than for long waves. So some of the basic results that now can be explained by models, then that was the first time it was possible to measure them. Now, I thought I'd compare that the place we went was exactly the same, within a few miles of this place, and this is Sverdrup standing there, and this was the 1931, many things that Sverdrup did between the Maud expedition and coming to Scripps was to go to the Arctic with Sir Hubert Wilkins in the Nautilus, which was a very dodgy submarine he converted. But Sverdrup did some very good oceanographic work via a diver lockout, but one of the crew, with an instinct for self-preservation, had sabotaged the diving planes, so they couldn't go very far under ice. But Sverdrup got a lot of data out of that cruise. But that was pretty much the same spot that we were working in 30 years later, and the submarines didn't look all that different, in fact. And this bottom one just shows how this is slightly later data, but how the attenuation rate varies with frequency and how it can now be fitted quite well by scattering theory. So that brings me on to the last thing I wanted to say as an introduction, which was that there was a reverse traffic of scientists between Britain and the US, especially Britain and Scripps. And so one of those scientists I was on a short visit, and many other British scientists came and stayed, and probably some of them are here. But I remember the first day I arrived on my first visit was at lunchtime in the summer, and Walter greeted me. He was wearing swimming trunks and sitting at that bench table that outside IGPP, just next to the statue. And everybody in the background, there were scientists going to and fro in shorts. Some of them carried surfboards. And I just arrived from cold, miserable, dreary, wet, damp, horrible Britain. And there's the sun shining and all the scientists are surfing. And in fact, one of them, I don't think it was that occasion, but slightly later one, was Michael Longit Higgins, who I remembered as a really buttered-up British scientist who subjected me to 3 hours of torture when he examined my PhD thesis. And now here he was, with swimming shorts, and a thing he said was a boogie board, and he said he was taking it down to study literal processes, not for enjoyment. So all this wonderful scene was spread out in front of me, and I was looking very confused because I'm coming from a miserable place. So I was thinking, well, you ought to be, why aren't you more miserable? So Walter spotted that, and he came up with a statement which I think ought to be used as a motto for Scripps. You don't have to suffer to do good science.
Sarah Perkey, faculty member here, who's going to run the morning session. And hopefully we'll We'll get the audio artifacts under control.
I have the honor of introducing three great speakers this morning. First up, we have Toshi Habiya. Toshi was introduced to me yesterday as Mr. Oceanography of Japan. Looking at his CV, it's not hard to see why. He is the president of the Oceanography Society of Japan. And when talking to him, I just got informed that he's running back to Japan immediately after this to head up the first joint JPGU and AGU joint meeting, which I hear many people here are heading to Japan to go attend. His research has focused on parameterizing dipeptidyl mixing in global models, but he has also dabbled in numerical experiments and fieldwork. I asked him yesterday what he would be talking about today, and he said everything. So with that, I'm going to let him start speaking. His title is What We Have Learned About Deep Ocean Mixing in the Past 20 Years.
Thank you for the introduction. Good morning. I'm Toshi Habiya from University of Tokyo, Department of Earth and Planetary Science. I'm so honored to have this wonderful opportunity to give a talk at this centennial symposium for Dr. Walter Mack. So, happy birthday, Walter. So, I'd like to thank Rob and Matthew for inviting me to this wonderful symposium. Thank you very much. So in this presentation, I'd like to talk, review what my research group in the University of Tokyo has learned about deep ocean mixing in the past 20 years. So, you keep in mind? Okay. So it is believed that large-scale thumbhand circulation of ocean are strongly control the climate over much of the Earth. The circulation results from downwelling and strongly cooled water near the poles and upwelling in the Indian Ocean and mostly and North Pacific. So this upwelling occurs because our downward density of cold deep water is decreased by our downward mixing of heat across some prime. So once upwelled into the up ocean, the water can flow back to the original location of deep water formation. So the global overturning circulation results. So global mapping of dipeptidyl diffusivity is very, very important for accurate modeling of global overturning circulation. So in order to sustain the overturning circulation, say, with a transport about 30 square drum, there are some sort of energy source for dipeptidyl diffusivity about 2,000 is necessary. That the abyssal density set. In the ocean, these energies are thought to be supplied at large scales by traveling atmospheric disturbances and tight bulb interaction, and then transport across local internal wave spectrum down to small dissipation scales. So, we first examine whether or not that your 2,000 gigawatt of energy is actually supplied to the deep ocean from barotropic tidal forcing and wind stress fluctuations. In particular, internal tides, one of the major energy sources for dipeptidyl mixing, and it is believed that 900 gigawatt energy is supplied from internal tide. So we first revisit this quantitative estimate of tidal-induced energy available for dipeptidyl mixing in deep ocean. so energetics. So we use the Princeton Ocean Model. Basic equations are there. Equations of motion and with an hydrostatic and viscosity approximation and conservation of temperature and salinity and the equation of continuity. Time is so limited, so I don't tell much about the model, but I'd like to emphasize that the docking time of the first mode internal tide is assumed to be 30 days. The horizontal resolution is 1/15 and vertically 40 levels. So this is an example of the calculated results of the showing the generation and propagation of semi-diurnal internal tide in the North Pacific. And also this is an example for diurnal internal tides in the North Pacific. So, for example, some significant energy conversion for M2 tidal constituent occurs Micronesia, 80 gigawatts, and Western Indian Ocean around Madagascar's around 53 gigawatts, and Indian Seas, 50 gigawatts, and Mid Atlantic Ridge, 43 gigawatts. Something like this. And on the other hand, significant energy conversion for K1 tidal constituent occurs Indian Ocean 19 gigawatt and East China Sea, Luzon Strait 11 gigawatt and Creel Island 9 gigawatt and Aleutian Ridge 8 gigawatt. So tidal energy dissipation rate are at each location can be calculated from the local energy conversion rate plus local energy flux divergence. For example, dissipation rates of semi-diurnal barotropic tidal energy and diurnal barotropic tidal energy are obtained and shown here. So our three-dimensional global internal tide model shows that global dissipation rate for M2 internal tide energy is 800 gigawatt. And the energy dissipation rate summed up for all the tidal constituents is about 11 gigawatt. However, at the same time, about half of the energy is dissipated in the shallow area with the depths less than 1,000 meter depths. So the energy available for deep water mixing from tides is about 500 to 600 gigawatts. How the energy supplied from traveling wind stress forcing? So for this such a quantification, we need to investigate both their global wind energy to surface near inertial motions and subsequent energy propagation into the deep ocean. So we can use very, very simple SLAM model like this to evaluate energy transfer from wind to surface inertial motion. We derive this SLAM model are using the realistic wind stress data for 1 year, like this. So in this calculation, the base of the surface mixed layer is assumed at the depths where water temperature becomes 0.5, lower by 0.5 degrees than that at the surface. Calculated results show their surface energy flux in the southern hemisphere is larger than that in the northern hemisphere. And there is a clear seasonal variation in the energy flux to the surface inertial motions. And the annually average global inertial energy flux amounts to 0.7 terawatts, 700 gigawatts. So to investigate how such energy supplied from wind forcing penetrates down to the deep ocean, we again employ the Princeton Ocean Model. The resolution is about 0.15 degrees and 71 layers in vertical. The calculation is for 1 year, starting from September 1990. Realistic wind stress fluctuations are taken into account. The vertical viscosity and diffusivity are derived using a modified version of Miller-Yamada turbulence scheme. The initial are state of the temperature and salinity are determined from the world ocean atlas, and heat flux is calculated from NSEP N-curve, the analysis data. This is an example of the results of a numerical experiment showing that the internal waves are generated by traveling mid-latitude storms and then propagate equatorward. A seasonal variation of wind-induced internal wave energy reproduced like this. The budget analysis is carried out for three regions in the North Atlantic, North Pacific, and Southern Ocean. In the North Pacific, for example, the annual mean wind energy input is 58 gigawatts from wind to a south mid inertial motion. And out of 58 gigawatts, 43 gigawatts is dissipated in the upper 150 meters. And 7.2 gigawatts energy is dissipated below 150 meters. Especially 2.3 gigawatts is dissipated below 1,000 meter depth, and the remaining 7.6 gigawatt energy propagates equatorward. So nearly the same budget, the result, nearly the same results obtained in the other basins. So we can find 70 to 80% of energy input went from wind as dissipated within the upper 150 meters. So therefore, even if remaining 25% is used quite efficiently for deep ocean mixing, the available energy is at most 0.1 terawatt. So adding 0.6 terawatt from tides, the total energy available for deep ocean mixing is about 0.7 terawatt. Just barely enough to support, say, a 10th square drop of global overtime saturation. However, we're still missing energy in the Southern Ocean, something like this. For example, we have not yet accurately evaluated the energy of internal lee waves generated by the ACC interacting with black ocean bottom. And in the Southern Ocean, we can expect deep water is directly upwelled by our equipment pumping associated with their strong westerlies. So anyways, we need some more study and what's going on in the Southern Ocean. So we'll move on to the energy cascade. The energy given a large scales by traveling atmospheric forcing and tight 12 interaction is transferred across the local internal wave spectrum down to small dissipation scales by nonlinear interaction among intergravity waves. So in this cascade process, parametric subharmonic instability plays a very, very important role. So we investigate the physical mechanism of PSI, parametric subharmonic instability. Now, suppose two are sinusoidal waves which are slightly different wave numbers propagating in their opposite direction, superpose. This superposition of such two waves create large wave envelope consisting of many fine waves. We call this wave, this envelope, BEAT, B-E-A-T, BEAT. Please note that this BEAT is different from the ordinary beat, which is created by nearly the same horizontal wave number, but propagating in the same direction. In this case, propagation direction is the opposite. So, when two near inertial waves with slightly different wave number propagating in opposite direction are superposed, what we call inertial beat is created. This inertial beat has a wave number k1 plus k2 and a frequency omega 1 plus omega 2. So the resonant triad for two high wave number inertial waves and one low wave number paraclinic tide means that this inertial beat and paraclinic tide, fast mode paraclinic tide, propagate with the same velocity, which enables the continuous resonant coupling between paraclinic tide, fast mode paraclinic tide, and inertial beat. To explain the application of near inertial current, we also introduce the effect of the background current convergence and the shear. Judging from the momentum equation, our fluctuating flow along the background convergence and fluctuating flow obliquely crossing the background shear layer are both accelerated. Because the fluctuating flow carries the momentum of the background currents such that the fluctuating flow is accelerated. So in this figure, upper panel, baroclinic semidiurnal tidal flow is denoted by blue L. Yeah. And the green arrow is the fluctuating near inertial current. So at time 0 hour and 12 hour, near inertial currents are accelerated because of the effect of background baroclinic tidal current convergence. And at time 3 hours and 15 hours, and 9 hours and 21 hours, near inertial currents are accelerated by the effects of background baroclinic tidal current shear. And 6 hours and 18 hours, the on the other hand, the near inertial currents can get out of the effects of background baroclinic tidal flow divergence. So the deceleration of near inertial currents never occurs. As a result, effective acceleration of near inertial currents takes place. A parametric subharmonic instability that transfers energy from low bargain mode to to a high wave number half frequency, high wave number internal wave half a Poisson frequency. There is a low frequency limit, F. So, for PSI to occur, Poisson frequency should be more than twice the local inertial frequency, otherwise PSI cannot occur. So this was actually confirmed by the numerical experiment of nonlinear energy transfer within the quasi-stationary internal wave field over Hawaiian Ridge and Aleutian Ridge, both are representative generation regions of large amplitude semidiurnal internal tides. Here is the outline of the numerical experiment. So in order to simulate a quasi equilibrium internal wave field spectrum, we first calculate nonlinear interactions among linear internal wave with the amplitude determined from the Gallup-Mach spectrum, or at the 2049 degrees north and 2028 degrees north. It's a latitude of Hawaiian Ridge and Aleutian Ridge. And thus, reproduced quasi equilibrium internal wave spectrum is disturbed instantaneously by the injection of first particle moving semi-down internal tidal energy. And evolution of the internal spectrum is examined another 10 natural periods to see how the energy injected at large scales is transferred down to small dissipation scales. This is a calculated result for the evolution rate, showing the time variation of the ratio of disturbed spectrum. Oh, I forgot to say that in order to examine the widely separated wave-wave interaction, so we did we carried out calculation in a particle two-dimensional plane. So this is a calculated result showing the time variation of the ratio of the disturbed spectrum to the undisturbed reference spectrum in the two-dimensional wave number space over 10 natural period after the injection of first particle moon semi-down internal tidal energy. So let's put here as the energy spectral location of semi-down internal tidal energy. The time goes in this way, and this is a vertical wave number and this is a horizontal wave number. We cannot find any significant increase or decrease of spectral volume within this two-dimensional spectral space. Things are quite different for Hawaiian Ridge. This is a calculated result again for Hawaiian Ridge, showing the time variation of the ratio of the disturbed spectrum to the undisturbed reference spectrum over 10 natural period after the injection of the first particle moves semi-down internal tide. In contrast to the previous case, as time goes on, the high vertical wave number near natural current shear gradually develops. The scale is about 10 kilometers in horizontal and several 10 meters in the vertical. So corresponding to this are near the Hawaiian Ridge. In the Hawaiian Ridge, such a strongly elongated pancake-like structure gradually develops in the deep ocean in Hawaii. And such a pancake-like structure cannot be found in the evolution ridge. So once such a high volume of inertial current shear is created, surrounding internal waves, especially high horizontal wave number internal waves, are efficiently double shifted to small dissipation scales, and the turbulent mixing that occurs very, very rapidly. Over the evolution ridge, semi-down internal tidal frequency is about 1.3 times the inertial frequency. So such a parametric subharmonic stability doesn't work, and injected internal tidal energy stays at a low vertical wave number. So things are schematically shown here. So below 30 degrees, such a high wave number inertial current shear is created. So surrounding internal waves are double shifted small dissipation scales, and strong turbulence occurs around this high wave number shear. So to see the distribution such a high wave number inertial current shear in the real ocean, we deployed our expendable current profiler, XCP. At the same time, we observed local buoyancy frequency by deploying XCDD to evaluate the dipole diffusivity. And to evaluate the dipole diffusivity using Mike Gregg's paper from 1989. Field observations are carried out around the ship track shown in this figure. In particular, extensive observations are carried out in the North Pacific, where 500 set of XCP, XCDD are deployed. This is an estimated value of dipole diffusivity in a sound crime, say a depth between 900 down to 1500. It is clearly shown that estimated dipole diffusivity is strongly dependent on latitude. The estimated dipole diffusivity in sound crime over evolution range and emperor seamount are remains of the order of 0.1 centimeters per second, 0.1 max. Below 30 degrees north, it rapidly increases, exceeding 1 max, or sometimes approaching 2 max. So there is obvious latitudinal dependence of that kind of diffusivity in the sun prime. The latitudinal dependence of that kind of diffusivity that's observed is consistent with the numerical prediction that the cascade of internal tidal energy down to dissipation scale is dominated by parametric subharmonic instability, which is expected to occur only below 30 degrees north. In later years, using this is the first Japanese domestic microstructure provider, TAMAP-D, by using this instrument, such a latitudinal dependence of typical diffusivity are confirmed through the direct microstructure measurement. So based on this, the XCP observations are superposed here. So based on these observed results, we made a global map of that diffusivity diffusivity like this. I believe this latitudinal dependence that becomes diffusivity under some crime should be somehow incorporated into our global ocean circulation model. So finally, I'd like to introduce our recent progress in the formulation of the fine-scale parameterization, first for ocean interior and next for deep ocean, but rough ocean bottom. Quantification of turbulent mixing through direct microstructure measurement is still very, very difficult because they take several hours and require special instruments such as a VMP 6000 or something like that. To overcome this difficulty, several kinds of parameterizations are proposed to infer turbulent mixing in terms of fine scale parameters. The existing fine scale parameterizations are based on the theoretical model by Heine et al. When the local internal wave spectrum varies its energy level E, while maintaining the same spectral shape as the Galois-Monk spectrum, turbulent dissipation rate is scaled in terms of the energy level E and buoyancy frequency L. So in this case, the ratio of KE to PE, a kinetic energy to potential energy, remains constant, so that a total energy E can be estimated in terms of either kinetic energy or potential energy using the shear information or strain information. However, if their internal wave spectrum is distorted from the Galois-Monk in the frequency domain, this parameterization doesn't give the same prediction value. A very crude parameter to measure distortion of our frequency spectrum is kinetic energy to potential energy ratio, namely fine scale shear to fine scale strain ratio, R omega. When the internal wave spectrum maintains the same spectral shape at GI, at omega equals 3. If there are internal wave spectrum is distorted to higher frequencies, potential energy gets larger. So R omega potential energy relativity gets larger. So R omega becomes less than 3. On the other hand, if the internal wave spectrum is biased toward lower frequencies, the kinetic energy gets larger, so R omega is greater than 3. According to the HWF Henry Wright Pratt model, the turbulent dissipation rates can be expressed by the product of internal wave energy density DEDN the Doppler shifting dm dt. So in this formulation, bracket indicates here integral in the frequency domain. So in terms of r omega, dE dm can be easily scaled in this way. As for dm dt, Doppler shifting, on the other hand, frequency dependence of dm dt can be expressed in this way using the dispersion relationship. We denote this correction factor hereinafter mu. To estimate the exact value of mu, we definitely need our knowledge about the inertial internal wave frequency spectrum. So we artificially distort the frequency spectrum and examine the r omega dependence of mu using this artificially distorted spectrum. In particular, for large values of r omega, internal wave field is dominated by near inertial waves. So, mu can be expressed in terms of omega exactly. However, if this single wave approximation is applied for all the values of r omega, the values of mu at r omega 3 becomes by a factor of 3 smaller than the required value at gm value. The GHP parameterization removes this discrepancy at r omega 3 by simply multiplying a constant factor like this. So, because of this multiplication, the GHP parameterization overestimates their theoretical value of mu for large r omega. One possible way to resolve this error is to introduce a threshold value r omega, which separates the internal wave field with a broadband frequency spectrum, including a Galois mark, and the internal wave field with narrowband frequency spectrum characterized by a prominent near inertial peak, this one. In this way, we modify the correction term like this. This is the correction term of GHP, and red one is our correction term. So this correction term, r omega dependence for small values of r omega, has a stronger r omega dependence for small values of r omega, and follows a single wave approximation for large values of r omega. To assess the validity of this correction term, we carried out simultaneous measurements of turbulent dissipation rate, fine scale shear, and the strain using a multi-scale profiler with B5500. Field observations are done using this multi-scale profiler at several locations near representative topographic features in the North Pacific, like in Aleutian Ridge, the Emperor Seamount, and Isowasser Ridge. And we can confirm that the correction time, our correction time, modified from GHP is more consistent with field observation, this red dots. So finally, I talk a little bit about parameterization over a vessel bathymetry. Bottom intensifier mixing hotspot is thought to play a very crucial role in the sustained global orbitonic saturation. Probably the most widely used parameterization for bottom enhanced mixing is one developed by Centrone, 2002. Their parameterization, however, it depends on several ambiguous parameters, such as energy dissipation rate at ocean bottom and its particle decay scale theta. In particular, the particle decay scale of energy dissipation rate is assumed to be universally constant at 500 meters. So in order to check the validity of this parameterization, we carried out a pair of a vertical two-dimensional numerical experiment to see the effects of ocean bottom roughness by employing the two kinds of bottom topography data. Number one, the high-resolution topography data in the Brazil Basin from a multi-beam observation. And number two, a smooth version of the same topography, excluding the variation with their with horizontal scale less than 2 kilometers. So excluding the variation with horizontal scale less than 2 kilometers. In both, their background field is a kind of a Garrett-Mark-Internal wave field. This is a summary of this calculation. Red line shows their magnitude of energy dissipation rate at rock ocean bottom and its particle decay scale. And blue one is the energy dissipation rate over at the smooth topography and its vertical decay scale. And you can see here, there is a clear trade-off relationship between the energy dissipation rate at ocean bottom and its vertical decay scale. However, this numerical experiment covers only a small range of parameters. Actually, internal wave generated by tight orb interaction can be classified in terms of the strength of a tidal advection effect measured by a tidal flow amplitude times roughness of bottom topography divided by a tidal frequency, and the degree of density stratification by SARA divided by a tidal frequency. When the tidal flow amplitude is very strong, when the tidal flow amplitude is small, linear internal tides emanate from the ocean bottom, propagating around the beam. In contrast, when the tidal interaction with bottom topography becomes strong, the generated internal wave more like a quadrupled internal leeway. So we have not yet clarified how this generate quasi-steady internal relay interact with the background Garrett-Monk internal waves to create mixing hotspot. To answer this question, we perform a series of our iconal calculation for a wide range of physical parameters to examine energy transfer from upward propagating internal relay to the dissipation scale through nonlinear interactions with the background two-dimensional Garrett-Monk internal waves. Please note that the initial frequency and initial group velocity of their internal leeway packet emanating from the ocean bottom can be obtained from the dispersion relationship. We calculated the trajectory of upward propagating which of the randomly distributed 2,000 internal leeway packets emanating from the ocean bottom for 80 internal tidal frequency, tidal cycles, and also the Doppler shift of the horizontal and vertical wave number of each internal wave packet through the interaction with the backend horizontal and vertical shear in the Garrett-Monk internal wave field. When the vertical wave number of each internal wave packet is Doppler shifted up to the cutoff wave number 0.1 CPM. This internal wave packet is assumed to break. Since energy flux emanating from the ocean bottom is not calculated in a corner experiment, all that we can obtain from this calculation is normalized energy dissipation rate based on the energy density of each internal wave packet at the breaking depth and its lifetime. By fitting the calculated results to this structure function, we can get a fraction of normalized dissipation rate at ocean bottom and its particle decay scale, Z0. This is a result by corner calculation. This is a cube, and this is T0, particle decay scale, and the fraction of normalized energy dissipation rate at ocean bottom. We can see that particle distribution of bottom enhanced mixing is more dependent on the tidal flow amplitude U0 rather than the horizontal wave number of bottom topography KH. As U0 increases while keeping KH constant, the scaled energy dissipation rate at ocean bottom Q rapidly decreases, whereas the particle decay scale by energy dissipation rate C0 rapidly increases. Such a strong dependence on ocean bottom roughness, KH, cannot be found when U0 is constant. So, the results of these iconal calculations are schematically summarized in this figure. So long as there are tight topography interaction is weak, generated internal wave it becomes a kind of a linear internal tides. And the parameter dependencies of the vertical group velocity and lifetime are such that vertical structure of mixing hotspot become strongly controlled by bottom roughness, KH. In contrast, as tight topography interaction becomes strong, generated internal wave become a kind of quasi-steady internal re-waves, and the parameter dependence of vertical group velocity and lifetime are such that vertical structure of mixing hotspot become mainly controlled by amplitude or tidal flow, UM2, rather than by KH, bottom roughness. So, in order to check the validity of this diagram for dipeconomic mixing over life ocean bottom, we are now doing an experiment using a VMPX that can go down to the ocean bottom, down to the ocean bottom, and leaving the sensor port and weight here. The data logger port will follow up, and we recover this. This is very, very expensive. Well, each time I have to give up $5,000. But well, in return, I can get the data throughout the ocean bottom. So doing this kind of experiment, I'm gonna now check in the validity of this diagram. So time is running out. So maybe we are now doing some trying to do some project for Indian Ocean and Southern Ocean. Yeah. The two parts we are now interested in. Okay, so we'll skip the conclusion. Okay, thank you.
Then you were relaxing to a profile of it. the first paraclinic model. Is that right? Did I understand that?
Oh, I see. There are several versions. Yeah, I think let it go. I mean, this is first fish, right?
Right, but how do you know? That depends on the stratification. So do you specify the stratification?
I specify that from volumes and atlas.
Because, I mean, in the overturning problem, the stratification is part of the solution.
Okay.
So it's
we have to be careful now.
So Toshi, Kurt, who's not here,
GHB. GHB. GHB.
I'm sorry?
GHB. Okay, go ahead.
did you test against his, he's got this recipe for how deep, how far off the bottom the internal waves will radiate from the rough bathymetry. So it's similar to your iconal calculation. And he does the wave-wave interactions and he uses that. So do your results compare with that favorably? Or have you looked at that comparison? It's a 2009 paper that he has.
Okay, so, yeah. I'm not prepared, compared yet.
Okay, yeah, it might be worth
it. But this includes anyways a strong non-interaction as well.
Yeah, he uses all those interaction theories to say what the spectrum is and how quickly the energy should propagate through. So then he does get variable, what you were calling Q. Mm-hmm. He gets variable Qs and for getting the depths different. So yeah, it might be worth checking.
The point is that depending on the parameter, generate the wave becomes a kind of a D-wave rather than internal tides.
Right.
So particle group velocity is much larger than the internal tides. That's a point.
Joe, just really quick. I was thinking about that study too. Do you remember if Kurt had a background GM wave field in those speculations, or he was just looking at the?
No, they were self-interactive,
right? So I guess I was going to ask you: do you get a very different result when you take away the background GM wave field?
Quite different.
Very different.
Quite different.
Okay.
So background GM is very, very important.
A good, very interesting comparison.
Okay.
Okay, first of all, it's a great job, I think.
Thank you.
What I've seen. And the question about the upper layer. You said that the big percent of the wind generated internal waves or so are dissipated in 150 meters or so, right? But in the upper layer, as far as I understand, the Gaitman spectrum should be modified. It's not the classical one. So did you take it into account, or how did you do it? Or you did not use it in the upper layer at all?
First of all, we are not incorporating the Gerard Mach into this model. But that's a transparency, transparent. And about 50% of wind-induced internal wave energy, near inertial energy, resides more than five modes, six modes, seven modes. So scale is very, very small. Easy to be, dissipated in the upper layer. We are now incorporating the modified version of Mary Mara and upper ocean. Yes, I think it's not working.
Thank you.
So wind-induced energy is not available for deep ocean, just 0.1.
Hi, thank you, very interesting talk. I have two questions. The results are very similar to the DNS results that we have for isolated.
May I switch off?
For the isolated reef that we have. My first question is, in your summaries that you had a KU over omega line, what is the value of the KU over omega which separates that two regime for you?
Why this separate.
What is the value of K?
It's one.
But my second question is, what would be...
But one second, it depends on the front bias R. Maybe. Order is one.
Order is one. It's about the same that we have to. What would be the big difference if you remove the gain waves from simulation? If you only let the beams interact with each other and remove the gain wave field, what would be the biggest difference in it? Are you seeing any huge difference in that?
You mean the additional approach?
In your dissipation profile without gain waves and with gain waves. So what would be the difference between in your dissipation profiles without gain wave field and with gain wave field in your periodic fields simulations?
Oh boy.
It's the same question I've asked before. It's a computer, yes. Yeah, there's no interaction if there's no GM. You need other waves to track.
But they generate waves themselves as well. This is
pretty. That's right, but it's just a mathematical calculation. Or he sends one wave packet.
Thank you.
I don't
know. Yes, Rob. Okay. Yes.
Yes. I'm glad you put that back up because I find that a really interesting idea.
This one?
Yes, leaving something on the bottom. But if I understand correctly, it's like right on the bottom. And so, as far as I can see, you will probably get a really good record of epsilon, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's doing any mixing down there, because you would expect very near the bottom there will be essentially no stratification. So I'm wondering, is your goal to measure just epsilon, or is your goal to measure dissipation?
I understand.
Buoyancy flux.
Yeah.
And if it's buoyancy flux, how are you going to get that sensor package off the bottom?
Yeah, expendable, but program that we are not carrying the CDD right now. We are not carrying the CDD with this. Maybe we have to think about that. You think N is very important information, right?
Yes.
To convert the
next.
Yes, I understand.
Because on the bottom, N may be zero.
Right. Yes.
And then in that case, you will have to figure out some way to get it off the bottom.
All right. That's a very good point. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that is following up. Can we tighten it up along or just throw it in the bottom? Can you take data on the bottom?
Data down to the bottom.
To the bottom.
Down to the bottom, to the bottom.
Yeah.
So is this planning to break this broke on the bottom and don't think it's not
going to be that? So, you've got 10 to be 100 microstructure sensors,
Microstructure sensor, you mean the temperature, right?
Yeah, so your temperature microstructure as well as velocity?
No. Right now, no. No FPO7. Just a shear sensor. Just because this is very expensive. Just carrying one shear sensor, no two shear sensors.
So, Toshi, I have a question.
Some of when you did these economic calculations to look at the K scale on the bottom, you had pointed out to us what it is and what you did. It really was to use a kind of a 300-meter K scale everywhere. That was so
500. Yeah,
anyway. But it was motivated by some comparisons at deep site using microstructure that was used. And I think people have gone on started to look at other machines like these machines and stuff.
Right.
But that number we used wasn't motivated by something. You've come up with much larger pay scales. Do you have more evidence of seeing these much
the erosion?
Yeah.
Well, that's a good point. That's the reason I bought this VMBX. Yes, I'm not done. Just learned calculated results. Yes, so this is just a prediction, numerical prediction. The B-well regime, we might have such a, maybe the internal gravity waves penetrate, going up before it is given out to the surrounding internal gravity waves. Yeah, that's the point. B-well group velocity, but group velocity, it's much higher than the internal time. That's the point.
I just have this odd comment here that I shouldn't have on Toshi, he's done more work than many of those other stuff. But we seem to be willing to debate the nature of the nonlinear interactions of these upward-going waves that are making this exponential decay in great detail, but there's absolutely no enthusiasm I detect amongst the group for actually going out and trying to observe it. And I would feel more comfortable worrying about what the nature of these nonlinear appearances are and how V waves penetrate up versus how material waves do. If there were some space-time observations of the things that go along with the theory, does anyone else share that enthusiasm, or is it profile in epsilon or in 17 models that all agree that it should be that way, even though you have different physics? Add this forward and put the next one.
New direction.
That's what they generally enthusiastic.
can I follow up on that? Well, because I also think that's really interesting, and I mean, these, especially the Lee waves that you're seeing, you see these profiles and you take one shot through it, but you don't know whether it was actually tides or the mean flow, or at least the low-frequency mesoscale eddy flow. And I think that's actually a really interesting question, right? Because the energy for the dissipation comes from two very different energy sources. So it seems to me that we really need to start looking for some more evidence of these things.
So southern ocean is very, very complicated.
Yeah.
So it's an ACC, a tidal flow, yeah, and waves.
Right, but not just the southern ocean. I think, I mean, Gunnar has started going out and doing, you know, deep spatial sections of these things. And obviously Kurt has, you saw from his talk, and I think we're starting to see more and more of these, but I think there's still a lot to learn.
What bets and dimes is that some of the interfacial topologies of those regions dominated by the strong reports, not by tidal.
Right.
You have a regime where you study it. You know that it has to be.
For sure. That's right. In this phone passage, too, and then there's this, you know, in general, the regime is probably mixed between the mean flow and the tides in there, you know, how you sort things out.
Maybe it depends on the location, maybe? Observe the location.
And it does.
Yeah, but those angles from one to rock. There are different regimes that they have already in the story. It would be a matter of comparing in the same one, the same one, the difference.
Why don't we thank Toshi and Dave Hoff for
the commitment?
Let's first get me back in the.